May God help us to know in our heart of hearts that we are His, and He is ours, and we belong to Him.
Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today.
Good morning, Steve. How are you today?
I'm well, thank you. I've been up and had a really interesting experience lying in bed this morning around 5:30. So we'll start with that after we pray. I don't know how much of a teaser that is. But anyway, let's pray. Father, thank you for being with us all the time. And thank you for little glimpses that you give us. They're precious, and we hold on to them, and we value them. And I pray that you'll help us today as we consider our topic. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I don't know what prompted it. It may have been, you know, something that you see on Facebook. Sometimes I stop, and I feel like I just do a quick overview of people's lives. You know, if you just scan through Facebook for 2 minutes, you're seeing people all over the country at all different levels of life and the whole thing. And somebody was talking about a death in their home, and I think that impacted me. But I was lying in bed, and I kind of saw my life all the way, all the way from the beginning. I'll just touch on a couple things. But my mom, I didn't know this until we had our own children, but she raised me to be independent and used to try to encourage Sandy and I to let our boys be more independent. But I think she felt like we were doing too much for them or something. But she raised me to be independent. And I also, as I've mentioned before in this podcast, my dad was not a significant part of my life. The first 5 years, he was only home on weekends, and probably looking back now, probably pretty tired. That's his time to catch up, time to regroup for the next week of work, and had to pay bills and different things. So I'm not sure how present he was even during weekends. But at the same time, we are built for connection. We are created to live with people. We need people. That's just a fact. Some people say, no, I'm a loner. I don't buy it. We all need people. And if we don't find what we need in certain situations, we look in other situations. And as I look back, I felt like I saw how God had provided people for me to lean on and people to support me and people to encourage me. And I remember a certain Sunday school teacher that when I was 5 years old, I could not leave Sunday school without giving that teacher a kiss. And I remember one time we had driven up the road about a half a mile, and it dawned on me. I had forgotten, and I was devastated. And my parents turned around, drove me back to the church. I ran through the halls, and I found her, gave her a kiss. So I don't remember a lot about that, but apparently she was a very special person in my life. And I went all the way through. It was just like I got this little overview of my life. And I saw not only friends that God had provided and friends in high school and friends in college. I thought of girlfriends that I had, mentors. When I became a Christian, significant roles in my life. And then when I got married, in many ways, I leaned on Sandy more than she knew. She's been my rock, you might say. She was steady. She's steadfast. She's solid. I'm sorry. She's also very sweet and soft. I don't want to paint her as a picture I'll get in trouble with
later.
We
won't tell her you said that.
Okay. But you know, I did. And then in 2012, it was a weaning time. Now, I've written a book on that called Crisis to Christ because it was the most devastating time of my life. It's the hardest year of my life. And I realize now it's because it was one of the few times I didn't have people to lean on. I felt like I lost my wife and my kids. I felt like I lost connection with a business and ministry. And I was alone in a way that I hadn't been for a long time. But at the same time, it was as if I had been skating, you might say, along the sideboards of the skating rink. You and I know what that means. When you first learn to skate, you don't go far from that wall because you can always go back and lean on it. You can hold on to it. But when you first start taking those little baby steps out on the rink all by yourself, boy, you're fragile and you're faltering. And yet, during that year, I felt like I got a hold of my dad in heaven, his hand. He reached down and held me in a new way, and I started leaning on him in a way that I'd never had before, because I had a wonderful support system, a wonderful Christian friends, a wonderful family, but it was of God, and it was okay. And that's why I also say that 2012 was the best year of my life, because I connected with God in a much deeper way than I think I ever would have before with my wonderful support system. And then I thought of the song that was written in the 60s, which was new when I first heard the gospel in 1968, called He's Everything to Me. The song should be sung at my funeral. So if I die tomorrow, just make everybody know this. So here you go. In the stars His handiwork I see. I could do a commentary on almost every verse because I love the stars. But in the stars, His handiwork I see. On the wind, He speaks with majesty. I love going outside and the wind blowing. I'm becoming an outside guy now because of my walks with God. I love just being outdoors because I've connected with God outdoors. And when the wind blows, it makes me think of the Holy Spirit. So, though He ruleth over land and sea, what is that to me? Till by faith I met Him face to face, and I felt the wonder of His grace. That happened in Colorado, 1968. Then I knew that He was more than just a God who didn't care. Now, that, as you and I know, is a complete fallacy. But that's what it seems like. He's just way up in heaven. Now I know that He knows me and loves me. But anyway, back to the song. Than just a God who didn't care that lived away out there. Now He walks beside me day by day, ever watching o'er me lest I stray, helping me to find the narrow way. He's everything to me. And that chorus especially is meaningful. He walks beside me day by day, especially since 2012, in a much deeper way. Now, you've probably read the poem about the footprints. Mm-hmm. Footprints, and it talks about how this person has a similar experience. They're looking at their life, and they notice that in the hardest times, there's only one set of footprints, and they say, God, how come you weren't there when I needed you the most? And He said, that's when I was carrying you. It was kind of like that this morning. As I look back, I saw that He was always walking beside me, but now He walks beside me in a much closer way. And He's helping me to find the narrow way, which is very meaningful. I've been meditating and studying on Jesus being the way. And you're probably going to hear a podcast on it shortly, but it's so powerful that He helps us to find the narrow way. And He's everything to me. In a whole new way, He is. I thought He was way back in 1968, but He continues to grow and grow and fill the horizon. And I like that passage that says, I will set the Lord always before me. And I love Him in a way I've never loved Him before. I see Him more than I've ever seen Him before. So anyway, that's how my day started. And I got up and I wanted to journal it before I forgot it, because I don't know about you, but I sometimes get some really good stuff, but if I don't write it down, I forget it. But last week we talked about how much Jesus, in my opinion, needed to hear His Father tell Him that He was His Son. And we talked about Psalm 2, this day have I begotten thee. Thou art my Son, this day have I begotten thee. And the references all through the words that He received at His baptism, very meaningful. And I just want to take it up a notch today and focus on the fact But not only does God make us his son, he makes us his beloved son. And there's a couple hymns that have found their way into my heart. And we'll start with some scriptures, though. Song of Solomon, two verses, powerful verses. I am my beloved's, and my beloved is mine. That's in Song of Solomon 6:3. 7:10, same book, says, I am my beloved's, and his desire is for me. And this is God's heart, I believe, for all of his children, is that we continue to know him more, grow closer to him, lean on him more, until he becomes everything to us. And part of it is the recognition is that we really are everything to him, which is hard for us to take in. And perhaps one of the main reasons we have children. My sons now are 41 through 33, and they're still my sons. They're mine, and I love them, and I love being with them. I love interacting with them, and that gives me a little microcosm of what my Heavenly Father must think about me, my wife, my sons, all of us, because he wants us to know that we belong to him, that we are his, and he is ours, and his desire is for us. 1 Corinthians 3:23, the context is they were debating, I belong to Peter, I belong to Paul, I belong to Apollos, and Paul clears the air, and he says, 3rd chapter, 23rd verse, you are Christ's, and Christ is God's. Christ belongs to God, and you belong to God. You are Christ's. Now, here's a song. I don't know if you know this. I'll actually sing it for you this morning, since I'm all feeling perky. I belong to the King. I'm a child of his love. I shall dwell in his palace so fair. For he tells of its bliss in yon heaven above, and his children in splendor shall share. Here's the chorus. I belong to the King, I'm a child of his love, and he never forsaketh his own. He will call me someday to his palace above. I shall dwell by his glorified throne. And that just one sentence has been reverberating in my heart. I belong to the King. I'm a child of his love. We talked about it a little bit last week. Jesus needed to hear it. And I was surprised doing my research to see how many times God kept telling him, you are my son. And I believe Jesus counted on those words. And then there's so many scriptures. We read a whole bunch of them last week. And because of what Jesus has done for us, we have been adopted into his kingdom. So here's another song. I don't think you can take two verses or two songs being sung. So I'll just read this one. Loved with everlasting love, led by grace that love to know, Spirit, breathing from above, thou hast taught me, it is so. Oh, this full and perfect peace, oh, this transport, all divine, in a love which cannot cease, I am his and he is mine. I'm not going to read all four verses, but I am going to read the last line of the next three verses. Since I know, as now I know, I am his and he is mine. May God help us to know in our heart of hearts that we are his and he is ours and we belong to him. Third verse. I'll read this verse. Things that once were wild alarms cannot now disturb my rest. Closed in everlasting arms, pillowed on the loving breast. Oh, to lie forever here, doubt and care and self-resign, while he whispers in my ear, I am his and he is mine. His, forever his. His forever, only his. who the Lord and me shall part? As we know from Romans 8, nothing can separate us from God's love. Ah, with what a rest of bliss Christ can fill the loving heart. Heaven and earth may fade and flee, firstborn light in gloom decline, but while God and I shall be, I am his and he is mine. So that's the message for us all to get a hold of today, that we belong to the King, that we are his. We belong to Christ. He belongs to us. It says in Lamentations, the Lord is my portion, therefore I will hope in him. That's Jeremiah. That's his bottom line. When everything around him was falling apart, he kept going back to this truth. No, I belong to the King. I belong to the King, Jesus, when everything else was all gone. No, I am my beloved's and he is mine. So there you go. What do you think about this?
Amen. Things? I was trying to think of some of the songs that have helped me with that, because it's funny how these huge biblical truths, to me anyway, somehow feel more real when I hear them in song sometimes. And I was thinking of the song Hold Me Jesus by Rich Mullins, which I don't know of another song that really quite puts it like that, but it's so powerful. And
well, I agree with you. I have never appreciated hymns like I do now. There's something about it's when your body, soul, and spirit are all unified in the truth.
Yeah.
Your emotions are involved. Your soul is involved. Your mind is involved. Your heart is involved. And it's the most, I'm trying to think of the word. It's the most synchronized. It's,
yeah.
You know, that we get. Because we can read stuff, but our mind can be other places. But when we are focused on singing God's praises, those truths somehow, they get to me differently. And I happened to be at work the other day, and I didn't realize somebody was on the other side of the wall. And I was sitting in there with my computer on my lap, and I was singing a hymn. And this lady comes around the corner a little bit later. Were you singing? I just like to sing hymns. Yeah.
Well, and if you think about music, and this is kind of a tangent, but if you think about music, there's no reason, like there's no practical reason that God created music for us, and he had to have created it, because otherwise why would we have it? I think it ministers to us in a way that simple words don't sometimes, and it helps bring truth into our heart that may have just been stuck in our minds.
Hey, can I read you a passage from Job?
Sure.
This is when God is talking to Job, poor Job. The Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge, et cetera, et cetera. Fourth verse, where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? And then he says, or what were its basis sunk, or who laid his cornerstone? In the seventh verse, when the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy. Isn't that a beautiful picture? So while God was laying the cornerstone for the earth and sinking its bases, the morning stars were singing and all the sons of God were shouting for joy. I think that's beautiful.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So I think, and by the way, when you read your Bible, you'll see that Moses, of course, he was really gave structure, you might say, to the children of Israel. He taught them God's law, which God taught him. He built the tabernacle exactly how he saw it in heaven, exactly how God passed on to him. He was very careful about that. But it was David that instituted the giving of thanks and singing hymns. That was a Davidic thing. Moses had the law and the temple, the tabernacle, etc., but it was David that instituted. And I think you and I can, all of our listeners can agree, there's very few people that knew God as well as David or loved God as much as David. And the Psalms are a testimony to the singing of truths and how they enhance our relationship with God, because they certainly enhance David's. Okay, let's pray. Father, thank you for this truth. I don't know how to say it very much, but you don't just love us, you belong to us. And you don't just call us to come to heaven and live eternally, but you call us to yourself. And you keep beckoning to us, and you keep gently knocking at the door of our heart and inviting us to go deeper with you. And I thank you for the hard times. I thank you for all the mentors that I had that were there. But I thank you for you yourself, by your Spirit, holding my hand and carrying me. And thank you for becoming everything to me. Thank you for 2012, hard year, but a good year when I learned to lean on you in a new way and hold your hand. I pray that this truth, that you are ours and we are yours, I am his and he is mine, I pray that somehow by your Spirit, you will convey that truth into all of our hearts of hearts, that deep recesses of our being. Make us know that we belong to you, that we are your children, that we are, because of Jesus, we are pleasing, we're adopted, and we're a part of your family. We worship you, Dad. We love you, Father. And we commit ourselves to you today in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email Steve at spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at Scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.